So today I'll be discussing about the information theory, which is an essential part of this digital communication system. So far in the last few lectures, we have discussed about the transmitter and the receiver block diagram of a digital communication system. And ultimately what we have found is digital communication is all about sending and the receiving bits of zeros and ones. So if I consider a transmitter set over here, as a black box, and already we know what is there inside the black box. There are different units called we have a sampler, we have a quantizer, then we have encoder. And in the last class, hopefully I have discussed about the role of pulse shaping filter. So there are different units within the transmitter, and as well as there are different units within the receiver block. So if I would like to observe this transmitter as a black box like TX and receiver as another black box like RX, we have also discussed the different components which are present within the receiver. More specifically, I have talked about the mass filter receiver in maximizing the peak pulse signal to noise ratio. Now, this transmitter and receiver, they are connected by means of a channel. Now, the channel could have been wired kind of channel or wireless kind of channel. Now, the information which is being, or the data, I should not use the term information, rather, the data which is being transmitted from the transmitter side to the receiver side for a digital communication environment is nothing but a strain of zeros and ones. So within the channel, a bit stream like this, 0 1 1 0 1 1 0, like this, a train of ones and zeros are being transmitted. Now you know how to transmit the zeros and ones. So you have different types of line codes, like you can have NRZ kind of line coding, you can have an RZ kind of line coding. So there are different types of line coding format, and accordingly the signals will be transmitted from the transmitter to the receiver side. So here, so far we have considered the 0 and 1 as the message information or the data which is being transmitted from the transmitter to the receiver side. Now we have come to an important concept of digital communication system, and which is known as the information theory. In fact, the root of this information theory was there long back in the year 1948, when the greatest scientist Shannon has come up with his landmark paper on information theory. Now, before discussing the Shannon's concept in this regard, which is known as the Shannon's source coding theorem, let us try to understand what are the different attributes that a digital communication system must satisfy. I have already discussed these attributes in some of the previous classes. Now, still, for the sake of completeness, let me point it out once again. One of the attributes is all about the efficiency of the system. What do you mean by the efficiency? And the second attribute is the reliability. Now, let me discuss what is meant by efficiency and what is meant by the reliability. So efficiency is one of the attribute, and second one is the reliability. So these are the two attributes that a digital communication system must satisfy. Now, before discussing the concept of efficiency and reliability, let us try to understand what are the important resources of a digital communication system. So here I am not considering the hardware components, rather the basic requirements that a digital communication system must possess. So obviously you must understand that within the transmitter there are different blocks, within the receiver there are different blocks, but apart from that, the basic resources that a digital communication system or any communication system will employ is, first one, the resources which a system must possess for the communication to take place. So number one, the power, and number two is the bandwidth. So these are the two essential parameters on the basis of which we can compare the different schemes of any communication system. So what do you mean by the power? So as you understand, power and bandwidth, these are the two important attributes, and these are very these are kind of resources which you want to use in an efficient way. What do you mean by the using those parameters, those resources, in an efficient way? That means for a given system, you would like to utilize a power which is as small as possible without hampering the behavior of the system. Similarly, for the bandwidth, as you know, this is a kind of resource, and depending upon the amount of bandwidth which is being provided to any service provider. So in our mobile communication system, we do have different types of service providers, the government service providers and the private service providers. And the government of India, they allocate the bandwidth depending upon the corresponding requirement as posed by those different companies. So this is known as the spectrum sharing. So the spectrum which is being provided to each of them, each of the companies, is all about the bandwidth. So we need to, those companies need to purchase those bandwidth, right? So bandwidth and power, these are the two important attributes. These are the two important resources which a communication system must use in an efficient manner. Say they don't want to use these different parameters like power and bandwidth as per their wish. So these are the two resources which has to be used properly. And as far as the reliability is concerned, what do you mean by the reliability? So whether the transmission from the one end to the other end is reliable or not can be measured with respect to several parameters. And already we have discussed one such parameter, which is known as the beta rate. That means if you transmit, say, n number of bits from this side to that side, from transmitter to receiver, and out of n number of bits, if you find that there are r number of bits in error, then r by n will be the bit error rate. And one of the prime objective of any digital communication system is to reduce the amount of bit error rate. So already we have mentioned that a typical value for this BER, typical value, even if you consider television communication, typical value of BER is almost in the order of 10 to the power minus 9 to 10 to the minus 10 in this particular order, 10 to the minus 9 to 10 to the minus 10. So you expect that if you transmit 10 to the power 10 bits like this, then out of this 10 to the power 10 bits, at max, one bit can be found in error. Now, if the number of bits found in error is more than one, then obviously you are losing in terms of the bit error rate. And moreover, perhaps you have understood that this bit error rate is having a serious implication with the power and the bandwidth. That means if you use more power, then obviously the bit error rate will be reduced, because ultimately, apart from bit error rate, there is another parameter which we should consider, which is known as the signal to noise ratio. So bit error rate is known as BER in short, and signal to noise ratio is known as SNR, signal to noise ratio. That means the ratio between the signal power and the noise power, signal to noise ratio, SNR. And in one of the calculations, I have already seen that these BER and SNR, they are related. That means the bit error rate can be represented as the ERFC function of EB by N0, and EB by N0 is regarded as the signal to noise ratio. So obviously bit error rate and signal to noise ratio, they are also dependent with each other. That means if signal to noise ratio is large, SNR is large, then one can say that the corresponding BER value is small, and vice versa. And how to make the signal to noise ratio large? The signal to noise ratio can be made large if you use more power for the transmission to take place. And on the other hand, the bandwidth is also having some serious implication on the bit error rate, and accordingly the performance of the system will vary. So one of the objective of any communication system is to set up a communication environment which is efficient as well as reliable. Now, in this particular module, we will be talking about the information theory, and in this regard, we will look at the term efficiency only. And in the next unit, whenever we will be talking about the different types of error correcting codes or error control code, there we will be talking about the different types of reliability. Now, let us start with the concept of efficiency first. What do you mean by the term efficiency? Now, suppose, let us consider we have a source of information like this, which can emit a number of symbols. Now, for the sake of clarity, let me make it general, and let us assume that this source of information, this particular source, will emit symbols from a particular alphabet, say S. So S is the alphabet, and accordingly, so let me represent by this curly S. And which is nothing but, suppose there are, for example, say k number of symbols present. So S is the alphabet, the curly S is the alphabet, and it comprises of k number of different symbols, like S0, S1, S2, S3, up to S of k minus a. So for the binary case, we can consider that S comprises of only two different symbols, that is 0 and 1. And if I would like to make it much more general, in that case, this source of information will generate any signal from that particular alphabet, that is curly S, which is nothing but a set of S0, S1 up to S of k minus 1. Now, whenever this source of information is being produced by this particular source, then obviously you must understand that the corresponding information that I will be receiving is not the same. Now, let us try to understand what is meant by the information pertaining to the generation of the source of information. Now, while talking about the information theory, we should have the different properties. One is known as uncertainty. Second one is known as the surprise. And this gives rise to the information. Now let us try to understand the generation of a particular symbol from the source. So this is the source which can generate different types of symbols. Now this source can generate symbols from the alphabet curly S, S0 to say S of k minus 1. So there are k number of different symbols. Now if I consider that the generation of any particular symbol is regarded as an event. So event is nothing but the generation of a particular symbol. Say S of k, S of small k. This one is S of capital K. So let me mention it. This is capital K. Or if it is needed, I can also change this particular variable. Suppose generation of any particular symbol like S of I, where I can be 0, 1, 2, up to K minus 1. So event means the generation of a particular symbol SI. Now, before this event occurs, if somebody knows what is going to happen, then obviously there is no uncertainty about it. On the other hand, if the generation of a particular symbol SI is associated with a corresponding uncertainty, that means if I can always associate a kind of probability with each of the event, then there is an uncertainty before the occurrence of the event. For example, if I consider these statements, suppose statement number one is like this. Statement number one is, the sun rises in the east. So you can consider this as an event. Obviously, no symbol has been generated, but this is an event. The sun rises in the east. This is statement number one. Let us consider the second statement, like if I write like this, Indian cricket team बीट्स इंग्लैंड क्रिकेट टीम। ठीक इन अ टेस्ट मैच दिस इज स्टेटमेंट नंबर टू एंड लेट अस कंसीडर द थर्ड स्टेटमेंट लाइक दिस प्राइस ऑफ पेट्रोल क्रॉसेस रुपीज 100 पर लीटर इन कोलकाता। Let us consider three different statements. First statement is all about the sun rises in the east. The second statement is all about Indian cricket team beats England cricket team in a test match. And the third statement tells that the price of petrol crosses rupees 100 per liter in Kolkata. Now, if I consider these three different statements or these three different events, then you must appreciate that the first statement is always true. Every time you observe the sun in the morning, you will see that the sun always rises in the east. So you don't find a single morning where the sun rises in the west or sun rises in the north or sun rises in the south. So this particular statement is always true irrespective of the number of times you observe that particular event. That means there is no uncertainty about the statement number one. So statement number one is always certain regardless of the time you observe that particular statement or that particular event. What about the second event? Indian cricket team beats England cricket team in a test match. Now if I have to assume that these two cricket teams, they are almost comparable, that means if I consider say 100 such appearance, and out of this 100 appearance, let there be 50% times where Indian cricket team beats England, and for the rest 50% time England cricket team beats India. So almost say comparable, or it can be in any proportion like 30-70 or 40-60. But obviously you understand that this particular statement is not always true, unlike the first statement. First statement is always true. However, the second statement is not always true. If you observe it 100 times, then you will find that out of 100 times in a particular scenario, you will see that out of 100 times, 40 times this statement comes to be true, and for the rest 60 times, this statement comes to be false. On the other hand, if you consider the third statement, the price of petrol crosses rupees 100 per liter in Kolkata, now it may be there is a possibility that that particular statement might be true to some extent, but if you consider it almost say say 5 years back or say 10 years back or even 1 year back, then obviously you understand that okay, the occurrence or the probability of this particular event is almost zero, that you don't find a situation where the price of petrol crosses rupees 100 per liter in Kolkata. Now we have the provision that the price of petrol changes every day by say 10 paise or 20 paise or say 50 paise, either it increases or decreases. So obviously the petrol price is not constant. Sometimes it is more than 90, sometimes less than 90, more than 85, less than 85. And so just like this, if you just observe the petrol price every day in the morning, then you will see that out of say 100 occurrence, say you might find one scenario when this particular statement comes to be true. So it might not be city Kolkata, might not be some other city in other parts of the country, you'll find that the price of petrol crosses rupees 100 per liter. So what I can say ultimately, that each of these three events, they are associated with some probability. Now the first statement is having a probability of one. So I can always identify a corresponding probability with each of them. So for the first statement, S1, which is always true, that means there is no uncertainty. There is no uncertainty, it is always true. And as a matter of fact, the probability of occurrence of the first statement P1 is equal to 1. It is always true. Now, what about the second statement P2? The second statement, as you understand, it is almost comparable. These two cricket teams, India and England, they are comparable. So the probability is close to 0.5. So for the sake of simplicity, I can consider it to be like 0.5 only. So you can select it to be like 0.4 or 0.6 or 0.3, 0.7, depending upon your preference, assuming that the value of this probability is close to 0.5, because I'm assuming that these two cricket teams, they are almost comparable as far as their performance is concerned. And so if you observe it, say 100 n number of times, so out of n times, probably n by 2 times, you'll find that Indian cricket team owns, And for the last rest in by two times, England cricket team wins. So accordingly, the probability is very much close to 0.5. On the other hand, if I consider the third statement, that is the statement number 3, P3, here you find that the probability is very small and it is like, say, let it be say 0.01 or so. So if you observe it 100 times, out of 100 times, you'll find that at least one occurrence is there where the statement comes to be true. Otherwise, the statement turns out to be false. So for each of the event, I can always associate a kind of probability. So if there is no uncertainty about any particular statement, any particular event, then there is no surprise. So after the event occurs, there is no surprise. So whenever the sun rises in the east in the morning today, so we are not at all surprised because we know that it is the sure thing which is going to happen. It is obvious thing which is going to happen. On the other hand, the Indian cricket team beats England. So if you hear this particular information or this particular statement from newspaper or from the television or from internet, if you get this information, then since the event is to some extent uncertain, it is not at all true always, so you might be surprised to some extent, but your level of surprise was not that much. Okay, Indian cricket team might beat Australia in Brisbane. So there is a possibility that Indian cricket team might beat Australia in Brisbane. You were surprised because the event was uncertain, but your level of surprise was not that much because you have the belief, you have the faith on the Indian cricket team that they can beat Australia in Australia. So there is a possibility, however small it may be. But at the same time, we cannot say that that particular statement is certain always. That means out of 100 times, if India plays Australia in Brisbane, and they will beat Australia 100 times. So this is not possible. So it is not a certain event, uncertain, but the level of surprise was not that much because you have the prior knowledge. And what about the third statement? Price of petrol crosses rupees 100 per liter in Kolkata. So you understand that it is almost. So you cannot just visualize things. This particular statement that the price of petrol might cross 100 per liter in Kolkata or any of the state of this particular country. So it is, if I consider the corresponding probability associated with that particular statement is very small. And if the front page of the newspaper, if you observe that the price of petrol has crossed rupees 100 per liter in Kolkata, then you will be totally surprised. You'll be completely surprised because you have never thought of like a situation like this. So as a matter of fact, each of these events or each of these statements are associated with a kind of uncertainty, with a kind of surprise, with a kind of information. Now, if the event occurs, before the occurrence of the event, if there is any uncertainty associated with the event, then after the event occurs, then there will be a surprise. And after the event occurs, there will be a gain of information, that you have gained some information from the occurrence of the event. Now, if I consider the first statement that the sun rises in the east, since the corresponding probability is always one, so you are not gaining any information just by observing that particular statement or that particular event. So since the probability is one, so the corresponding information content is equal to zero. On the other hand, if I consider the second statement, since the probability is less than one but greater than zero and almost close to 0.5, so it is a little bit more uncertain statement, and the level of surprise will be medium, and you'll be getting some information after knowing this particular statement. And what about the third statement? The third statement talks about the petrol price is almost close to 100 rupees per liter, crosses rupees 100 per liter. Then you understand that it is almost uncertain. And accordingly, whenever the particular event occurs, then you will be totally surprised. And the amount of information that you'll be gaining from this particular statement, it will be the maximum. So accordingly, you can consider that if I have a newspaper like this, then if I consider the newspaper like this, this is the total area. And there are certain news and certain events which take the major portion of the newspaper. They're highlighted. And there are certain news which are not that important, relatively unimportant, and they have only small area allocated to them. So that depends upon the probability of the occurrence, right? So if some event is less probable, then the corresponding level of surprise is much more as compared to the other events which are much more probable. So accordingly, the information content in any particular symbol or in particular event is associated with the probability of the occurrence. So what we can say is the information is inversely proportional to the probability. If the probability is high, then the corresponding information content is low, and vice versa. And you know that the probability of any event is always limited by this particular limit, that it can be greater than or equal to zero, but less than or equal to one. So accordingly, the information value can also be modeled. Now, if I just once again go back to our previous discussion, that we do have a source of symbols like this. So we do have a source of symbols. Which can emit source of symbols which can emit any arbitrary symbol from the alphabet curly S. So S0, S1, S2, and so on, and up to there are, say, k number of such symbols, S0 to S of k minus 1. And if I know that at any particular time instant, the corresponding output of the source, if it is fixed, if it is deterministic, that if I know that irrespective of the number of times I observe this event, the output is sure to be, say, S2, or the output is sure to be S1, or any other particular value, then obviously there is no uncertainty about it. You know what will be the corresponding output of that particular event. So there is no uncertainty about it. Under this condition, whenever the event occurs, you are not at all surprised, and you will not be gaining any information out of that. On the other hand, if each of them are associated with a kind of probability, which I can write like P of 0, S0 is having a probability of P of 0, S1 is having a probability of P of 1, S2 is having a probability of P of 2, and so on, S of k minus 1 is having a probability of P of k minus 1, then the corresponding information content will be different if none of these p is equal to 1. What I mean to say is that p of k or p of I is nothing but the probability that s value is equal to si. So p of I is nothing but the probability that the outcome of this particular event, which I modeled like a random variable like capital S. So this capital S is a random variable, a discrete random variable, because the values are discrete. It's a discrete random variable. So there are k different possibilities, where k is a finite number. So that's why if I want to model these variables like S0, S1, S2 as a random variable, so it will be a discrete random variable. This capital S is a discrete random variable, which can take on k different values like S0, S1, S2, S3, up to S of k minus 1. Now, the probability that this discrete random variable capital S will take on the value Si is given by P of I. So accordingly, each of these symbols will be having the corresponding probabilities, P0, P1, P2, and so on. Then, what about the information content? So the information content pertaining to the symbol SI, as you have already mentioned, that it will be inversely proportional to the probability. So the inverse, so the information content, I can write this as a log of 1 by PI. Why have you used log here? Because, as you know, if I consider the statement number 1 of the previous slide, that the sun rises in the east, we know that if the probability value is equal to 1, that this particular event is sure to happen. There is no uncertainty about it. You are not at all surprised about the occurrence of the event. That means what? You are not gaining any information. You never find in a newspaper highlighting a news like this, today the sun rises in the east. Rather, you will find that in the newspaper, you will find that yesterday Indian cricket team beats Australian cricket team in a test match at Adelaide or at Brisbane by 5 wickets or 10 wickets or by 200 runs or 250 runs. So you'll find that this is the kind of statement which can take the highlights from any of the media, maybe a social media or print media or television media. And on the other hand, if a statement like this, the price of petrol crosses rupees 100 per litre in Kolkata, then it will take more place in any of the news. So accordingly, if the probability is maximum, that is one, there is no uncertainty about that. So under this condition, the information content is null. There is no information out of it. So one can write this like log of 1 upon pi. So if pi is equal to 1, that means if the event is sure to happen, then the corresponding information content will be equal to 0. It suggests that if pi is equal to 1, implies I of si, that means the corresponding information gained after the occurrence of the event is equal to 0. Now, what about the base of this logarithm? Now, if the base is selected to be 2, under this condition, if the base is equal to 2, then the unit of this information is calculated in bits. Why is it so? I would like to explain. So if I write that I of si, that means the information gained while the event output is equal to si, or the random variable output is equal to si, then this is given by log 2 base 1 upon pi. Now the unit is bit. Now let us consider the experiment. Let us consider the experiment to be tossing of air coin. That is the experiment. So you can regard this particular experiment as a random experiment. Tossing a fair coin. So this is a random experiment, and the corresponding outputs can be regarded as a random variable. So you can have two different possible outputs. One is head or the other one is tail. Now, if the coin is really fair, in that case, the corresponding probabilities are also same. That means if you toss the coin 100 times, you will find that out of 100 times, 50 times it will be head, and for the rest 50 times it will be tail. So what about the probability associated with head? So probability associated with head is given by the number of times it is found to be true, that is 50, divided by the total number of observations, that is 100. And that is equal to the probability of tail as well. And this is equal to 0.5. So accordingly, the corresponding output of the random variable can be marked with some levels. So you can consider that head is identified by a 0 and tail is identified by 1, or vice versa. Because we have only two different possibilities, either 0 or 1, either head or tail. So I can regard this output as 0 and this output as 1. Now, if I consider this value of probability, like 0.5, that is half. And for equiprobable, binary outputs. So here the output is binary, either 0 or 1, either head or tail. So for equiprobable binary output, what we find, this information content I of si can be regarded as log 2 base 1 upon 0.5. So 1 upon 0.5 is 2, log 2 base 2 is 1, that is 1 bit. So as you understand, bit is the acronym for binary digit. So bit signifies binary digit. So 1 bit is the amount of information. So what is 1 bit? This is nothing but I of SI. So this is equal to I of S0 or I of S1. Or I can write I of SH or I of ST. That is equal to 1 bit. So what is 1 bit? 1 bit is the amount of information that you get whenever the output of the random experiment will be equiprobable binary in nature. So under this condition, the amount of information that you gain is equal to 1 bit. So it is customary to use this particular base of the logarithm as 2 whenever the unit of the information is represented in bit. But you are free to select any other arbitrary value of the particular base, and in which case you can you are free to select the unit of the information content accordingly. So what we want to mention over here is that for any particular observation, say the symbol value s is equal to si, if the symbol value s is equal to si, it is always associated with some information, that is I of si, which is given by log 2 base 1 upon pi, and the unit here, the unit is in bit. Unit in bit. If I use 2 as the base of the logarithm. Now the information of any particular random process is always associated with some property. So let us try to find out the properties associated with the information. So the first property is that, let me write it down once again. What is I of SI? That is equal to log 2 base 1 upon pi. Now the first property says that since the value of pi is always bounded by this 0 less than equal to pi less than equal to 1. So I of SI, it's inversely proportional to pi. So when pi is equal to maximum, then ISI is equal to minimum. What is the maximum value of pi? The maximum value of pi is equal to 1. So what about the minimum value of information? The information minimum value of information content is equal to 0. Because if I put pi is equal to 1 here, then the corresponding ISI value will be equal to 0. So ISI, the minimum value, is equal to 0. In other words, I can write that ISI is always greater than 0. That means whenever greater than or equal to 0. ISI is greater than or equal to 0. When pi is equal to 1, then the corresponding information content equal to 0. And if pi is less than 1, in that case, the ISI value will be greater than 0. So the information content associated with the observation of any random experiment is always non-negative. So it is non-negative in nature. So you can write that there is a provision for gain of information always. Gain of information. ISI cannot be, I of SI cannot be negative. It can either be positive or equal to 0. So there is always a gain of information. There is no loss of information. I cannot say that ISI is negative. So after the event has occurred, after you observe that particular event, there is a loss of information that you can't say, because the value of ISI is always greater than or equal to 0. What about the second property? If I consider two different outputs like SI and SJ, SI with a probability say PI and SJ with a probability of say PJ. And if I assume that PI is greater than PJ, that means both SI and SJ, they are the outputs of the particular a random experiment. Or you can also consider these are the sample value of any discrete random variable. Now if SI is having a probability of PI and SJ is having a probability of PJ, and if PI is equal to PJ, that means we can say that SI is more probable than SJ. This signifies that SI is more probable than SJ. More probable than SJ, because the probability of SI is higher, that is PI is higher than PJ. Then from the definition of this information, what I can write is I of SI is less than I of SJ. That means a more probable event, more probable event is having lower information as compared to a less probable event. Here, since PI is more probable as compared to PJ, so the corresponding information content ISI is less than I of SJ. So similarly, if I consider these three statements, statement number one, statement number two, and statement number three, and if you compare statement number two and statement number one, you will see that statement number one is more probable as compared to statement number two. So therefore, the information content resulting from the statement number two is always higher as compared to the information content resulting from the statement number one. And the third important property is that suppose this particular source of symbol, as we have already mentioned, the source of symbol, so it will generate the symbols after certain interval. That means at interval T0, it will generate S0. Then at interval T1, it will generate S1 and so on. And if I assume that the generation of one symbol no longer depends upon the generation of other symbols, that means this S0, S1, S2, S3, they are produced independently. There is no dependence on each other. Then I can regard this kind of source of symbols as a discrete source of symbols. Discrete source of symbols, and at the same time, they are memoryless in nature. Why discrete? Because they can generate discrete number of symbols, k number of symbols, 0 to k minus 1, so k number of symbols. And moreover, since the generation of one symbol at any particular instant is no longer dependent on the generation of any other symbols at any other interval, so I can consider that this particular source of symbols does not possess any memory, in which case we can consider this particular source of symbols as a discrete memoryless source. And hence, for discrete memoryless source, if two symbols are generated, like SI and SJ, and if I would like to find out the corresponding joint information content resulting from the two symbols generated, then this ISI SJ, if I consider this together, ISI SJ, so this ISI SJ is given by ISI plus ISJ. So the corresponding information content will be added together. That you can prove it very easily, ISI plus ISJ. Because if I have two different symbols like this, SI, SJ, and if I would like to find out the information content while observing these combined symbols like SI, SJ, then what about the total information content resulting from this observation? So since they are independent with each other, so the probability associated with symbol SI is given by PI, and the probability associated with the symbol SJ is given by PJ. So the joint probability SI, SJ is given by PI into PJ because they are independent of each other. So I of SI SJ can be written as log 2 base 1 upon PI PJ. Now you know that log mn is equal to log m plus log n. So accordingly, if I invoke that particular property, you will see that I SI SJ is given by ISI plus ISJ. So this is all about the information content resulting from the observation of any particular symbol. Now whenever this discrete memoryless source, let me show it once again. This discrete memoryless source discrete memoryless source. By now, perhaps you have understood what is the meaning of this memoryless out of it. Now it generates source of symbols from that particular alphabet curly S, like S0, S1, S2, up to say S of k minus 1. And each of the symbols is having their corresponding probability and corresponding information content. So this is represented by I of S0, this is represented by I of S1, and so on. And the corresponding information content over here is I of SK minus 1. Then if I consider the total, this discrete memoryless source as a whole, then when it emits a source of symbols like this, then what about the average information content? So these are the individual information content resulting from the generation or from the observation of different symbols. Like for S0, the information content is IS0. For S1, it will be I of S1. For S2, it will be I of S2, and so on. Then what about the average information content? So this average information content, average information, you do have different information values like IS0, IS1, and so on. So average information can be written as, so you do have k number of such different symbols. So I should write I of SI, where I is ranging from 0 to k minus 1. But remember that each of these symbols, S0, S1, S2, they are not equiprobable. Their probability is different. So I cannot write like simple summation divided by the total number of symbols. Rather, I have to associate the corresponding probability. So it should be like PI times ISI. Because it is nothing but this S0, S1, S2, these are nothing but the discrete random variables. So there is a probability associated with each of them. So accordingly, this will give you the average information, or in other words, you can simplify this expression like this. I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 upon pi. And this average information as emitted from this discrete memoryless source is known as the entropy of the source. This is known as the entropy of the source, and it is being represented This entropy is being represented by this H of S. Remember that this entropy is a function of PI. PI log 2 base 1 upon PI. So depending upon the value of PI, the entropy will be modified. But in the argument, this curly S has been used to level the entropy. It doesn't mean that this entropy is a function of this curly S. Curly S is nothing but a set. It eventually depends upon the corresponding probability value, PI, where I is ranging from 0 to k minus 1. But this S has been used over here to make a level that it is related with that particular random variable, which is taking the value from the set curly S. That's all. So that's why this is known as the entropy or the average information content. Summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, PI log 2 S 1 by PI. Now, while considering this average information or entropy, we would like to find out what is the maximum value and what about the minimum value of the entropy, because this entropy is having some say on the value of the channel capacity, which has to be ascertained for the error-free communication in any communication environment. So let us try to once again, let me write down the expression for the entropy here. So this H of S, that is entropy, is given by summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 if there are k different symbols, and PI log 2 base 1 upon PI. Then what could have been the maximum and what could have been the minimum value for this entropy? Now, this is a simple summation, and within the summation you have two terms which are multiplied. One is pi, second one is log 2s 1 by pi. Remember that this condition is true, that pi is less than equal to 1 but greater than equal to 0. Now under this condition, what you find is each of the probability pi and log 2s pi, they are positive in nature. This is nothing but the information content, log 2s 1 by pi, and we have already shown that this log 2s 1 by pi, or the information content, is always greater than or equal to 0. And moreover, pi is also greater than or equal to 0. Now, in the expression of the entropy, we do have this summation, pi log 2s 1 by pi, where each of the terms are either 0 or greater than 0. So therefore, the minimum value for hs is equal to 0. So in other words, we can write that this curly s is always greater than 0 or equal to 0. Now, when you have this equality sign, this equality sign will be there if you find that if there is a particular symbol Sj for which Pj equal to 1, then obviously you must understand the properties I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, Pi must be equal to 1, the total probability must be equal to 1. Now suppose whenever this discrete memoryless source is generating the symbols like S0, S1, S2 and so on, suppose there is a particular symbol Sj. There is a particular symbol Sj for which the Pj equal to 1. Then what about the other probability value? It suggests that the other probability value, it suggests that the Pi is equal to 0 for all I not equal to j. Because the total summation equal to 1, P0, P1, P2, P3 up to PK minus 1 equal to 1. Now out of this k number, suppose there is a particular symbol like S of j for which the probability is the maximum, that is 1. So what about the contribution of the other different symbols? The contribution is equal to 0 because this particular event is sure to happen. So then Pi is equal to 0 for all I not equal to j. Now under this condition, what you have is Pi log 2 base 1 by Pi. And if you use the summation sign over here, then for I not equal to j, the corresponding value Pi log 2 base 1 by Pi will be 0. And even for I equal to j, this Pj equal to 1, but log 2 base 1 by Pj equal to 0, because log 2 base 1 equal to 0. So there you find that if one particular symbol is there, which is sure to happen, then for which the corresponding probability equal to 1 and the information content equal to 0, and for the other events, the corresponding probabilities are 0. So ultimately, the value of the entropy will be equal to 0. So the minimum value of entropy is only obtained when out of k different possible symbols, if one symbol is sure to happen. That means if I know that, what will be the corresponding output resulting from that particular experiment? That means there is no uncertainty. Even if this discrete memoryless source can generate k different symbols, but if I know before the actual event to take place, if I know what is the output I would be getting, what will be the output symbol I'll be getting over here with a full probability of 1, that means there is no uncertainty associated with that particular experiment. Now, since there is no uncertainty, obviously there will be no surprise. And as a matter of fact, there is no gain of information. So since there is no gain of information, so automatically the average information is also equal to 0. Because each of the information content equal to 0, so the average information is also 0. Now, it happens when if a particular symbol Sj is there for which the probability is maximum. Then what about the maximum value of Hs? So this is the minimum value Hs. the average information content, then what will be the maximum value of this entropy? And now to find it out, the maximum value, now let us consider a function like this to answer this question. So this is x and this one is y. Suppose this this point is say 1, 0. Now let us consider the straight line y is equal to x minus 1. So as you understand, when x equal to 0, x equal to 1, the output y equal to 0, and when x equal to 0, the output will be minus 1. So this will be, this point is equal to 1, 0. And this point is equal to 0, -1. Now let us draw another function. So this corresponds to y is equal to x minus 1, this straight line. Y is equal to x minus 1. And let us draw another graph which is for y is equal to log x. And as you understand, if x equal to 1, then y will be 0. That means this y is equal to log x will also pass to this 1, 0 line. And if x is greater than 1, then y will be greater than 0. And if x is less than 1, then y is less than 0. So this particular graph is for y is equal to log x. So from these two waveforms, what we can conclude is x minus 1, this value is always greater than log x. And they are equal for x to be not equal to 1, and x minus 1 will be equal to log x for x to be equal to 1. At x equal to 1, this y is equal to x minus 1 will be tangential to this particular curve y is equal to log x. So we will be utilizing that particular property for finding out the highest limit associated with the entropy. So x minus 1 value is greater than log s. So this is the observation from this mathematical derivation. Now to start with, we do have this discrete memoryless source. Discrete memoryless source. Now the corresponding output resulting from this discrete memoryless source can take on values from the alphabet S, curly S. And let us consider that this output, which can be modeled like this, S0, S1, up to S of k minus 1. Now let us try to impose two different probability distribution. In one case, you will find that these probabilities are like P0, P1, P2 up to P of k minus 1 in one of the events, in one of the experiments. And let us try to have another such probability distribution like Q0, Q1, Q2 up to Q of k minus 1. With the condition that summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, Pi is equal to 1. And similarly, summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, Qi is equal to 1. So this P0, P1, P2, up to Pk minus 1 will give you a set of probability distribution for a particular experiment or experimental outcome. And for a different experimental outcome, the corresponding probability distribution is given by Q0, Q1, up to Qk minus 1. And since they are the probabilities, So the condition has to be hold good that summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, pi must be equal to 1. The total probability must be equal to 1. And same is true for the second set of probability, that is summation k, I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, qi is equal to 1. Now let us try to find out this particular expression, I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, let it be, say, pi log 2 base qi by pi. So obviously, this is not the expression for the entropy, but let us try to evaluate that particular expression first, pi log 2 base qi by pi. So since we have the log 2 value over here, so what I can do is I can use it like so I can take this 1 by log 2 outside and I can use a natural logarithm, I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi natural logarithm, that log e base qi by pi. Now already you have seen that from the last slide that x minus 1, this value is always greater than log of x. Or in other words, I can write that log of x is always less than x minus 1. So you do have this log of qi by pi. So qi by pi is the argument over here. So I can take it outside, 1 log 2. Even this is true for any logarithm. So instead of writing log of x, if I use like x of n minus 1, so this value will be less than I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi. Instead of writing log of x, if I write like x of x minus 1, then it should be less than x minus 1. So what is x here? X is qi by pi, this minus 1. So this is less than. Or in general, you can also use this equality sign. It should be less than equal to 1 upon log 2. Then summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1. Then you do have qi over here minus pi. That means, so I should write over here only. If I break it, I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, qi minus summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi. You understand that each of these two terms, I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 qi and I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi, each of them will result in 1. So 1 minus 1, so ultimately the value is 0. So ultimately what we find is the summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base qi by pi is less than or equal to 0. What we have is a summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base qi by pi is less than or equal to 0. Now, when do we expect that this equality sign holds good? Now, we can expect that the equality sign holds good when qi is equal to pi for all I. If qi equal to pi for all I, then the equality sign holds good. That means the result will become 0. Now, under this condition, if qi is equal to pi for all I, then what will be the value of qi? That can be given by 1 upon k. Now, under this condition, one can write that summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1. If I would like to find out the expression for, let me erase that part, expression for the average information resulting from q0, q1, q2 and so on. So the average information qi base log 2 base 1 by qi. Under this condition, when qi is equal to pi for all I and the value is equal to say 1 by k, since there are k number of symbols and they are all of them are equiprobable, then that can be written as summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 qi, or I should write 1 by k over here. So this is 1 by k log 2 base k, assuming equiprobable symbols. That means all the symbols are having their probability to be the same. Then it gives rise to 1 upon k log 2 base k, and this is added k number of times. So ultimately, this value is nothing but log 2 base k. So summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 qi log 2 base 1 by qi is equal to log 2 base k when all the symbols are equiprobable. Now under this condition, if I would like to evaluate that expression, already we have seen that from the previous derivation that this summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base qi by pi is negative or at most equal to 0. So this can be written like this: summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, I can write pi over here, and log 2 base let it be 1 upon pi divided by 1 upon qi. So this is less than or equal to 0. So summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1, we do have pi log 2 base 1 by pi minus summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 by qi. This value less than equal to 0. So summation I is equal to 0 to, I think it will be better if I go to the next slide because there's no such place. So what we can write, summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 upon pi minus summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 upon qi is less than equal to 0. So from that we can deduce summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 upon pi is less than equal to summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 by qi. Now when pi is equal to qi, under the condition that pi is equal to qi is equal to 1 by k, that means all the symbols are equiprobable. Under this condition, that can be written as qi log 2 base 1 by qi with qi is equal to 1 upon k. And already we have evaluated that expression to be equal to log 2 base k. So it will be less than or equal to log 2 base k, where k is the total number of symbols emitted by that particular discrete memoryless source. What do you have in the left hand side? The summation I is equal to 0 to k minus 1 pi log 2 base 1 by pi. This is nothing but this entire expression is nothing but the entropy. So this log 2 base k is the maximum bound on the entropy. And already we have seen the minimum bound to be 0. So ultimately what we can write is 0 less than equal to h of s, that is entropy, less than equal to log 2 base k. So this happens, that means hs will be equal to 0. This happens when there is no uncertainty. When there is no uncertainty. So no information. And why no uncertainty? Because we know what is the output resulting from that particular source. One of the output is having a highest probability, that is 1, and the other outputs are associated with a lowest probability of 0. And this happens when maximum uncertainty. Why maximum uncertainty? Because all of them are having equal probability. We have k symbols from that particular source, and all of them are equiprobable. So under this condition, we do have maximum uncertainty. So maximum information. And what do you understand by H of S? H of S is nothing but the average information resulting from that particular source. So if the maximum information is obtained from each of the source, so the average information will also be maximum. So H of S will be maximum when all the symbols are equiprobable, and it will be minimum when one symbol is having a probability of 1 and the other symbols are having a probability of 0. Now this entire discussion has been for any generic discrete memoryless source which can generate k different symbols. Now let us try to restrict our discussion to a more specific one, for which case it can generate only two different symbols, like 0 and 1. So what I am saying is, I would like to discuss about the binary memoryless source. So as you understand, for a binary memoryless source, this alphabet will consist of only two different symbols, like S0 and S1. Or more specifically, I can regard this S0 as 0 and S1 as 1. With the corresponding probability, S0 will be having a probability of P0 and S1 will be having a probability of P of 1. Now, under this condition, we are ready to find out the average information. So the average information can be written as you know, now you do have only two values, I is equal to 0 to 1, P of I log 2 base 1 upon P of I. So this is nothing but P0 log 2 base 1 upon P0. Plus P1 log 2 base 1 upon P1 with the condition that P0 plus P1 must be equal to 1. So that can be represented as the first term, P0 log 2 base 1 upon P0 can be represented as minus P0 log 2 base P0 And then we have P1 as 1 minus P0 log 2 base 1 by 1 minus P0. So similarly, this is P0 log 2 base P0 minus 1 minus P0 log 2 base 1 minus P0. So this is the average information content or entropy of any binary memoryless source. Now, as you find that here, this entire thing has been represented in terms of P0 only. You can also represent the same thing in terms of P1, doesn't matter. But ultimately, it's a function of only P0. So what we can write is, over here, I can always regard this entire thing in the right-hand side as a function of P0 only. So I can write this like h of P0. Now, this is the expression for h of P0. Now, if you plot this function, h of P0, suppose this is P0, and this is h of P0, or entropy of that particular source, you'll find that when P0 equal to 0, so obviously P1 will be 1. So you're sure about the outcome. That means there is no uncertainty. So if you put P0 value equal to 0 over here, you will find that the corresponding expression h of P0 will become 0. Similarly, whenever you put P0 equal to 1, here also you will find that the corresponding value of h of P0 equal to 0. And h of P0 will reach its maximum value when P0 equal to P1 equal to half. And it will follow a graph like this. So this corresponds to P0 to be 1, this corresponds to P0 to be 0, and this corresponds to P0 to be 0.5. That means when the symbols are equiprobable, 0.5. Now under this condition, what will be the average information? Under this condition, this h of s max, maximum value, is given by 0.5. log 2 base 1 upon 0.5, this is for P0, and then plus 0.5 log 2 base 1 upon 0.5. So this will give you log 2 base 2, that is 1 into 0.5, and here 1 into 0.5. So 0.5 plus 0.5, that is 1. So 1 bit of information, 1 bit. So when a P0 equal to P1 is equal to 0.5, then the average entropy, I mean, the average information, which is also known as entropy, is maximum, and the value is regarded as 1. Now, let us extend the concept of this memoryless source to a more specific one, where so far we have considered that. Let us try to, I think it will be better if I would like to extend the concept by means of some example. So we do have a discrete memoryless source. Which can emit three different symbols, say for example, S0, S1 and S2, with a corresponding probability, say 1 upon 4, half and 1 upon 4. So P0 is equal to 1 by 4, P1 is equal to half, and P2 is equal to 1 upon 4. So it emits three different symbols, S0, S1, and S2. Let us try to find out what is the amount of average information. So the average information can be written as 1 upon 4 log 2 base 1 upon 4 plus half log 2 base, sorry, it will be 1 by 1 upon 4, so ultimately it will become 4 only. The probabilities are half and 1 by 4. So it will be 1 upon 4 log 2 base 4 plus half log 2 base 2 plus 1 upon 4 log 2 base 4. So it will give you log 2 base 4 will give you 2 by 4, that is half. So half here Here we'll be getting another half, and here we'll be getting another half. So ultimately, the average information is given by 3/2. 3/2 bits is the entropy of that particular source, which emits three different symbols, S0, S1, S2, with a corresponding probability of 1 upon 4, 1 upon 2, and 1 upon 4, respectively. Now, let us try to extend this concept to a more generic one, where we are interested in finding out the corresponding information content gained by us when two symbols are observed simultaneously. So it can generate S0, S1, S2 in isolation. Now let us try to observe the appearance of two symbols simultaneously. So accordingly, if I consider this extension for this extended source, first of all, we have to identify what about the symbols and what about the corresponding probabilities. First of all, let us try to identify what are the different symbols. Let us consider we are taking two symbols at a time. It will be like S0, S1. Or it could be like S0, S2. We could have S1, S0. We could have S2, S0. We could have S1, S2, and we could have S2, S1 as well. So out of these three different symbols, S0, S1, and S2, let us try to identify the different permutations which are possible. Either one can generate S0, S2, or one can generate S2, S0. One can generate S1, S2, or one can also generate S2, S1, or the other possibilities. So now let us try to find out the corresponding probability. So for S0, it will be 1 upon 4. For S1, it is 1 upon 2. So for S0, S1, it will be 1 upon 8 only. For S1, S0 also, it will be 1 upon 8. For S0, S2, it will be 1 upon 16. For S2, S0, we do have 1 upon 16. And for S1, S2, it will be 1 upon 8. And for S2, S1, it will be 1 upon 8. Now, for this particular combination, if I would like to find out the corresponding average information or entropy, so the average information or entropy. Can be written as summation okay it will be better if I find out the corresponding probabilities over here s0 s1 1 upon 8 s1 s0 1 upon 8 s0 s2 1 upon 16 S2 S0 1 upon 16, S1 S2 1 upon 8, and S2 S1 1 upon 8. So we do have 4 1 upon 8, 1 upon 16. So I can write like this 1 upon 8 log 2 base 8. And we do have 1, 2, 3, 4 such occurrence. So multiplied with 4 and 1 upon 16 log 2 base 16 and 2 such occurrence. So this will give us log 2 base 8 will give me 3 because 8 is 2 to the power 3. So it will become 3. And 4 by 8 will give me half. So it will give me 3 by 2. And here, log 2 base 16 will give me 4. 4 into 2, that is 8. 8 by 16. That will give me half. Let me check the calculation. 3 and 4 by 8, that means 3 by 2. Log 2 is 16. Log 2 is 16 will give me 4. 4 into 2, 8. 8 by 16, that is half. So ultimately, the average function entropy that I'm getting over here is given by 2. 2 bits. 2 bits of information, 2 bits of average information. So if I just want to compare the expression which I've already got for this one, here we do have three different symbols like 1 upon 4, half and 1 upon 4. So we do have three different symbols. So here k equals 3. So we do have k equal to 3. Three different symbols. So the entropy, the value of entropy as the k equal to 3. So the value of entropy was limited by 0 less than equal to h of s and less than equal to log 2 base 3. Now it will be equal to log 2 base 3 when we do have equal probability over here, like 1 upon 3, 1 upon 3, and 1 upon 3. But here in this particular case, these three different symbols, they are not equiprobable. The corresponding probabilities are 1 by 4, half and 1 by 4. So the maximum of HS is not obtained, rather the HS is limited like 3 by 2 only. Now for the extended source, we have taken two different symbols together like S0, S1, S0, S2, S1, S0 and S1, S2. Then S2, S0 and S0, S2. So accordingly, we do have six different possibilities and the corresponding probabilities we have considered over here, like 1 upon 8, 1 upon 16, 1 upon 8, 1 upon 16, 1 upon 8, and 1 upon 8 respectively. And we have calculated the corresponding average information or entropy resulting from this particular extended source is given by 2 bits only, as compared to these 3 by 2 bits that you have already. So here we do have a 3 by 2 bits of information, average information. On the other hand, if I would like to observe different sets of symbols, let us consider the same set which can emit like S0, S1, and S2 with a corresponding probability of 1 upon 4, half, and 1 upon 4. And let us consider the extended symbols like this, and the corresponding probabilities like this. So instead of taking 2 symbols at a time, if I would like to take 3 symbols, then I can write S0, S1, S2. I can have S0, S2, S1. Then S1, S0, S2. S1, S2, S0, and ultimately S2, S0, S1. And S2, S1, S0. What are the corresponding probabilities? The probabilities are just multiplied. So we have explored all the possibilities: 012, 021, 102, 120, 201, 210. So we have explored all the probabilities. So here in this case, since we have taken into consideration all the different symbols, so the corresponding probabilities will be the same. What about the probability? 1 upon 4 into 1 upon 2 into 1 upon 2. That will be 4 into 4, that is 16, and 2 over here. One upon 32 each. And here, if you would like to find out the corresponding entropy, this entropy is given by the corresponding probability is 1 upon 32 multiplied with log 2 base 32. And we do have 6 such occurrences. It will become 5 into 3. By 16, that is 15 by 16 bits of information. So here you find the average information is reduced. Whenever we are considering 3 different symbols together, S0, S1, S2, S2, S1, S0, and so on, the corresponding probabilities are given by 1 by 4, 1 by 2, and 1 by 4 respectively. So the joint probability for them is given by 1 by 32. And accordingly, we are getting less amount of information because we have not explored the other combination. That means we could have introduced this S0, S1 combination only. We could have introduced S1, S0 combination only. So considering 3 different symbols, I can have all the different types of combinations, like S0, S1, S1, S2, S0, S1, S2, S2, S1, S0, so that the total probability will be equal to 1. Now, if you consider this case and this case, here also, the total probability is not equal to 1 because we have not explored all the combinations. 1 by 8, 1 by 8, 1 by 8, 1 by 8. So altogether, it will give you 4 by 8, that is half. And here 1 by 16 and 1 by 16, that is 2 by 16, that is 1 upon 8. So half and 1 upon 8. So you do have half means 2 by 8, half means 4 by 8 and 1 by, so 5 by 8, so 3 by 8. So that probability has not been considered here. And here if you consider, we have 6 by 32 total probability. So apart from that, there are other probabilities corresponding to the other combinations. If I consider S0, S1 only, S1, S2 only, S2, S1 only. So here you can also incorporate the other probabilities so that you can completely investigate the entire set of symbols. And under this condition, the total probability will be equal to 1. But however, here I have considered different combinations of the generated symbols. And what we have observed that the average information resulting from the corresponding observation is different. If I consider a single symbol only, like S0, S1, S2 in isolation, the total average information is given by 3 by 2 bits. On the other hand, for an extended source, if I consider two symbols only, S0, S1, S0, S2, and so on, then the corresponding probabilities are like 1 by 8, 1 by 16, and so on. And the average information or entropy for this extended source only is given by 2 bits. And if I consider three symbols together, S0, S1, S2, and S2, S1, S0, and so on, then the corresponding entropy is given by 15 by 16 bits of information. Now, with this, I would like to conclude today's discussion on the entropy.